All right, so we are recording now, and this is the OERu technology working group session with only two of us in attendance.
I'd say we're probably not going to talk about it on the agenda, but I would say an action item moving forward is some outreach to grow the group out a little bit and see if we might bring some new members into it.
Well, I think this is pretty exciting stuff, and it has the potential to really amplify all the work that we're doing if people take on the technology and really learn how to run with it.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
That's one of its huge opportunities that it presents. I thought what I would do maybe is I'll share a screen here that I have, which includes all of our meeting notes. Let's see if I can find it here. At the moment, hang on a tick. It turns out that if you have multiple desktops, you can only share individual windows if they're on your main desktop, at least in Linux.
Oh.
Which is unexpected, but there you go. But even that doesn't seem to be working if I have not had it on the main desktop when I started.
Oh boy.
So that's a bit frustrating.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well what I'll do is I will share my whole desktop and I will just get rid of a few other things off of it. And in all going well, can you see my desktop?
Yep, it's working okay. Well.
So this is our agenda, and essentially what we're trying to do with this meeting is to let people know who have been following to various degrees of, with various degrees of intensity, have been following the OERu's technological progression towards suitable technology for delivering our minimum viable product of a full year of study with an exit credential. And we have not had any meetings for a reasonably long time, or fairly long time, but it's, that shouldn't suggest that nothing has been going on in the meantime as far as technology development goes. So what I'm hoping to achieve today is to effectively demonstrate or present a number of the things that we have achieved in the intervening months. So in the agenda, I've outlined a number of the types of things that we have been working on. We're thinking about things in terms of learner resources and collaborator resources, and I should probably also incorporate another category of technology, which is analytic resources, namely things that we can use to measure the success or failure, or the relative success anyway, of our technological initiatives and also our overall MVP. So one of the key things, obviously, you know, whenever you're introducing an innovative new way of doing things like what we're proposing to do with this MVP, we need to be able to determine what actually looks like success and what doesn't, and we need to be able to measure that. And so obviously we have to determine what it is that our learners in this case are going to be needing in order to be able to take advantage of the MVP. We need to know what the people who are putting together the materials and actually running the MVP courses need to be able to do, and then we need to know how we can measure that success. So I'll start a little bit with learner resources, just because I think they're kind of cool. My predecessor in this role, Jim Titzler, who you will be familiar with, Brian,
mm-hmm.
He wrote some very clever software which allows us to create a aggregated, well, so first I should say that we're delivering learner resources in the form of online course materials via a WordPress platform, which we call course.oeru.org. And so effectively we are able to create and present courses. The learning or the educational collaborators are able to create course materials and deliver them to learners. That's taken as given, I think. But what we are keen to do, in addition to simply present materials, is allow our learners to interact with those materials and with each other in useful ways. And one of the ways that is being done is via this concept called We Notes. And We, by the way, stands for Wiki Educator. So this is a set of capabilities that were built in the context of our Wiki Educator Wiki, which is what holds all of our educational resources, our open educational resources. And it serves as the point of aggregation for a whole bunch of disparate places in which people involved in our courses as learners and as educators might create artifacts or leave a digital footprint. So that's places like social media. So we have functionality that allows us, for example, to incorporate into a aggregated feed for each course that we offer through our WordPress instance, allows us to aggregate not only tweets that are appropriately tagged from Twitter, posts from Google Plus are a possibility, but we also have our own social media that we're making available, namely our Rocket Chat chatting environment, our discourse forums, our email groups, which are built with onlinegroups.net, and as well as individual ad hoc blogs, which might be, Blogger blogs or WordPress blogs or a variety of other kinds of blogs that people might have, and for which they then as learners provide a blog URL when they sign up for a course. So what it means is that anything that's been suitably tagged with the predetermined tag for a course automatically gets pulled in to a feed. Now I've actually pulled out a sample feed. I believe this is the one for the OERU partner meeting, which is coming up. In fact, I should have opened that in another tab. So maybe I'll just stop that and come back. Hang on. I'll let this finish loading. So we've got it behaves the same way as a course level feed would do. It's based on this tag OERU16, which is the tag which we've selected to be the one for this upcoming meeting. So tags can be for courses, they can be for topic areas, they can be for any number of educational contexts or organizational contexts. And based on that tag, we can create an aggregation of feeds. And you can see this is just postings from places like Twitter and from our chat system and from people's blogs. And you can see actually where they came from. You can see, I don't know if you can see my mouse here.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You can see that most of these are from Twitter at this stage for this particular meeting. But you'll find that if we go to a course specific session, let me find a course feed here. I'll just pull up CSF 101, which is a course that was a prototype course that we ran recently. And I believe there'll be some useful feed items in that aggregated feed. The feed actually appears in the context of the course. So this is what you're looking at here is an actual WordPress site, which was created specific to this running of this course. So each course that's run will have its own WordPress site, and it will be for a particular cohort for a particular course. So different partners can run the same course materials, but with their own modifications and with their own branding. And now for some reason, this is not showing. That's not ideal. It's possible that my machine is just simply struggling with the additional weight of the video conference as well. I'll just try reloading the page, make sure that. So what happens is you get to the course feed page, and then there's a service within the page, which automatically then pulls in the appropriate, it applies a filter based on the page that you're looking at, and it automatically pulls in the relevant feed items, at least in theory. Yeah, so, okay, we have got a, I'll have to find a better example of this, because we do have, we have a number that do work. I don't understand. So the other thing is people can actually post a WeNote post in the context of the actual course, nice. On the actual feed. So not only can they do it in remote locations where they already are, namely on places like Twitter or writing their own blog posts or using one of our different social media options that the OERu are providing, but they can also do it directly through the website. I'll just see if I can find a better... Well, one thing I can do here is I can go, for example, this is the OERu chat environment called provided by a tool called Rocket Chat. And so you can see here that we've got a number of different rooms or channels. And for example, we have one that is automatically populated by all the Wiki Educator notes, the Wii notes that are produced by our overall system. And so these are all of the notes that have been produced in the last, well, in all the different contexts. So any given Wii notes feed would have a subset of these that's specific to their set of tags. But this is kind of the superset, and it shows in each case, you can see that the specific tag that pulled it in, that caused it to be pulled into the Wii notes feed is shown. So you can see that some of these come from Twitter, some of these come from the online groups. So this is one from you, Brian. Mm-hmm. And some of them come from our actual our chat. So that's namely from this particular chat interface. And so, yeah, it tells you where they've come from. So that gives you an idea of how people can integrate or interact with, it gives the sense that there are lots of potential ways that people can get engaged with their work as learners. So it's not a consumer-based education. It is interactive. Mm-hmm. And the idea is to encourage that interactivity and to allow students to collaborate and provide mechanisms by which they can collaborate with each other, regardless of where they are in the world. So it's designed. Nice. To support the concept of open boundary learning. Okay, now let's have another look back at our agenda. You may well be familiar with the idea of course resource banks, which is something that our colleague Jim Taylor at USQ has been promoting for quite a long time as a nice way of allowing, it's a nice, I guess, pedagogical assistant or tool that can be employed in different courses to help build, allow learners to explore a particular subject area and to amass a catalog of useful resources. So one of the things we've done recently is we've actually adopted a system called, Semantic Scuttle. It's a very cumbersome name, but essentially it is web-based bookmarks that can be shared and tagged. So again, it allows us to potentially incorporate any tagged resources into a course feed like I was just showing you. So in addition to tweets, you could also tag things for your course, and they in turn would also be promoted to everyone else who's following that feed of content related to the course. And so people will see the things that you've made available in the course of your investigation as a learner, or for that matter, as an educator. And so the nice thing is, over time, that becomes quite a valuable resource that can be mined by students and educators alike. So the idea here is that you can actually, I don't know if you can see on my window, if you look at the bottom of my screen, you can see these little star icons. Mm-hmm. And I can go to a page that I think is interesting. So say, for example, this is our new technology blog that we've just started as a place to write about the technology decisions that we're making and some of the implications of those, and also to provide guidance to our partners who might want to use some of these technologies, having seen them through the OERU context. I can choose, for example, to bookmark this by clicking this icon. Now, of course, this will pop up in a different window, so it may not actually appear as a shared resource. And at the moment, it's not popping up anywhere, but it sometimes takes a second. But the idea is that I can just opportunistically see that there's something that I think is relevant to a course. I can click this button, and the interface that allows me to create a little annotated reference to that bookmark and then submit it to the bookmarksoeru.org site, this thing here, is just a simple click away. And it then allows me to do the tagging for specific courses that I might be taking. And also, here we go. I don't know if I can perhaps reshare this quickly here, just so that you can see the screen. I'll stop sharing this for the moment, and I'll start sharing. Ah, I see the problem. Here we go. And again, because I've had this come up on a different window, it's not letting me pick it. All right, since I'm sharing that desktop, I'll go back to that. Can you see, hang on. Here we go.
Can you see
that? Has come up. So yeah. Here I can just, so the URL that I've clicked on, where I, the page that I was looking at when I clicked on that little star icon, that's a plugin for my browser. And the plugin is available for Firefox and Chrome. And it gives me the details already pre-entered. And I can simply add tags, and I can add a description. And we can call this tag, we can say OERU, we could say maybe open source software, given that all the software that we're presenting today is open source. We could say technology, online learning, things like that. We could say OER, just because all of the stuff we're talking about are open educational resources as well. And we can just add that bookmark. And having added it, it should now appear in this list. So I'll close this window. It closes itself, actually. And I'll just reload this page. And with all things going well, it should appear here. And it doesn't. Hang on. There it is. Okay. No, it appears.
I feel like I'm giving you my demo mojo here, Dave. I might have to sign off.
Yeah, no, fair enough. I think you're all right. Okay, so I'll go back and do a look at a few other things here. I should also point out that one of the things that we've done for the benefit of learners, especially the ones that haven't worked out who we are and what we do yet, in the meantime, since our last meeting, we've actually created and commissioned the creation of a set of videos, and I don't know how many of our partners are aware of these yet, but we've actually created a number of pretty cool videos that are specific to learners and potential partners as well. As part of our marketing push. So I'm kind of loosely including those in the technology sphere because they're digital technology and they are digital artifacts and they are delivered via digital technology. So as part of this, we've actually got now a OERU YouTube channel. So you can see I've created a link to it. It's youtube.com/C OERuniversitas. And I believe OERU will actually redirect to that for reasons that are too complicated to explain here. But it turns out that OERU was not available, immediately available for us. So we had to commit to this channel, but subsequently it did become available. So now we're redirecting it to here. Mm. Anyway, so the idea here is that we can start to amass a set of interesting videos that we can both promote our own videos. So for example, this video, we could go, the video of this session can go on this channel following our meeting. But also our marketing videos will be available through this channel, and course specific videos will also be available through the channel in future. So all of our meetings will be sort of assembled here so that people can easily find them and perhaps create playlists of them, so that if someone wants to immerse themselves, binge watch all of our past sessions, they're welcome to do so. Okay. Now let's have a look at some of the things that we have been working on for collaborators. So again, we've got this improved marketing collateral like the videos, but we've also got file-based materials that are, might be of interest to our partners and collaborators. And I include these in the technology area as well, just because they're electronic documents and will require, for distribution purposes, they'll require, if partners want to make use of them as templates for their own, I'm not sure why that's just created a new tab. Apologies, my machine is crawling under the strain of the video.
Wow.
So yes, you'll see that we have templates, for example, course announcements. I'm just trying to work out why it's not scrolling. Hang on. Ah, okay, so somehow I managed to drag that tab out and what I'll do is I will reopen that window. Actually, no, I won't. I'll just, as you can see, everything is just at an incredible crawl. And it's no doubt as a result of the fact that I'm trying to share this. Okay, so I'm just trying to remember exactly where we were. Here we go. Okay. No, this isn't what I had in mind at all. It looks as though I have managed to drag my tabs in such a way that they are opening up new windows left, right, and center. And I just need to find my recently closed windows, because I ended up closing a window that I thought was going to be. Sorry, everything is just moving very, very slow, right?
If anyone's watching this in the archive, they might want to hit the scroll bar. But other than that, it's cool. We'll take our time, get things grounded.
Yes. Okay, well, nothing is happening quickly here. So what I'll do is I'll stop the share for a moment.
And okay.
See our faces, and maybe not sure whose faces will be visible, but
nice.
Yeah.
So we could probably even, I mean, we have links on the agenda. We could even talk through some of it, and then there might be one or two things you might just show very basically, even if we don't do walkthroughs the way you've done.
Sure. I just need to get my agenda, the agenda tab back up again, so I can look at it. Coming now.
I have it in front of me.
You have it in front of you? Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, we just covered kind of talking about marketing collateral, case studies, templates, logos. related to also the video channel before that. Just as an aside, I've been asked to create a short video here, and I'm working with some of my people here on blogging. And one of the things that was made available to us is actually some of the front and back screens and logos and things like that for video intros and stuff. So if people are in a position of doing that, a video that they want to be part of the OERu network, that is available to people, just so they know.
That's a good point. Yeah. Yeah. There's a, one of the goals of our, one of the goals of the creating the video collateral, I guess you could call it, was that we could make it so that our partners could create their own branded versions of them for their own purposes. So that, that was actually designed into the marketing materials.
From nice. The yeah. Very handy.
Yeah.
Okay. And then the next item on the agenda is enhanced analytics for online materials with utilities to do things like track use of links and materials shortened by our link shortener, which is a cool thing in itself.
Yeah. Yeah, that one is hard to see because it basically it's designed to be invisible. Ah, there's Wayne.
Oh.
Hello, Wayne.
Hi, Wayne.
Howdy, how are you doing?
Doing well, thanks.
Let me just see here. I just wanted
to... we were all set now. We've created a new we ended up creating a new meeting so that we were the hosts of it. So we're able to video it. So the this is being videoed.
Yeah, and no worries. Because one of the things would be worst, from memory, I thought the host could assign host rights to somebody else.
I think you can when you create a meeting. You have to create a list of other potential hosts. From what
I can. I think there was a way of doing it actually live.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm not too sure.
Something we can check. So, what did you just change the link?
We've created a whole new new meeting ID. I created a meeting ID, and so that we could host it that way. And I've updated the agenda.
Yeah, but folk have got the. If they've got the link in the email, oh no, the link wasn't in the email, right?
No, the link was to the agenda, so that we had more flexibility with regard to the actual meeting details.
Yeah, I understand.
I've managed in the course of my machine grinding to a halt while the video was going at the same time as I was showing things. I've managed to get rid of a bunch of my tabs that I'd pre-opened to make them handy, and I'm just trying to bring back the actual meeting agenda.
Is it helpful if I sent a link in a text chat or something?
You could send it in this chat. The problem I have is it should be here. I just need to be able to pick it from amongst all of the other. Here we go.
Okay.
Got it. So, yeah, we were just in the process of looking at some of the collaborative tools that have emerged since the last time that we had a technology working group meeting. And we're also looking at things like the introduction of some of the analytics functionality. Now, you mentioned, Brian, that you were talking about the Mautic. I'll just... yeah, sorry. You were talking about the link shortener. I thought it might be worth just showing people what the link shortener actually looks like, because as I said, it's kind of invisible to the end user by design. Mm. But if you, what I'll do is I'll share what it looks like when you have the ability to log into it, which only a few people do at the moment.
Okay.
But the idea behind it is that every time we create a marketing-based email, we can replace all of the links in that email with references to the, I'll share this page, by the way, references to the link shortener. And as a result of that, we can then see when people actually click on the link. We don't get a lot of, we don't get privacy related data or data that would have a bearing on people's privacy, but we just find out that people have actually clicked on a link so that we can determine, for example, whether a particular style of email results in more more interest from the people receiving it or less. So we have the potential to measure those sorts of things. So just for example, this is a set of, if you can see this, this is a set of, I'll see if I can enlarge this a little bit. This is a set of our links that have been created in the course of our marketing initiative. And these links have then appeared, or many of these links have appeared in our mailouts to course participants, for example. And the idea then is to actually be able to record when people follow a link. And so you can see the number of clicks that some of these have. So essentially, we have a shortener which says that the links then have, so that they're easy for people to pass on to each other, the links are just using the domain name oer.nz, and then it will be slash, and then it's typically a letter until we run out of letters, in which case it will start being two letters, and then three letters, and then four letters. But within those four letters, we should, and numbers as well, we should have the ability to manage probably all of our foreseeable links for the next 10 years or so. And the idea is that we can, it's both a convenience for people if they want to propagate our links by telling them to people, because it's shorter than having to remember the actual full link. But we can also then see when people have clicked on it and get analytical information from it. Similarly, we're also using something called PWIC, which is like Google Analytics, but an open source alternative to Google Analytics, which actually records when people click on links on our various websites. And over time, we're hoping to use that and also possibly Google Analytics to allow us to do things like even look at the effectiveness of different quiz and assessment models that we might use, and the effectiveness of certain kinds of questions and the layout of quizzes and things like that online. So by having the ability to record how people are clicking on things, we can improve the design. We can adapt and respond and improve the design of our materials.
Nice.
Okay. So I'll go back to the agenda. And so I've already mentioned our chat system. I will bring another window in here. So there is a desktop application. You can access our chat system in your browser just by going to chat.oeru.nz. Sorry, chat.oeru.org. And you can, so there's a link to it there. But you'll see that there are a whole series of channels that you can join. There is the potential for private channels that only certain users can access, but most of our channels are openly accessible to anyone who decides to log in. And people can participate in discussions that are pretty much real time. The other thing is these discussions are retained and are available for searching. So someone can actually click on search and they can search back through messages in useful ways. There are also mechanisms whereby participants in the channel can actually initiate a video conference, either all of the people in the channel or just a few. They can also do it via phone. I don't know if you can see this. So this is a new functionality that's built into most modern browsers, which is called Web Real-Time Communications, WebRTC, which is an open source, open standard as well for web applications. You can also manage the way that you're notified if people talk, that people can mention you the same way that they can in lots of other social media. They can mention you, and you can choose how to receive and when to receive notifications via email that something is happening in the chat that might interest you. And we can also use this as a place to upload documents and to share them. And then there's the ability to mention people so that you can easily find content that pertains to you because someone has specifically mentioned your handle. So in my case, it's at Dave Lane. And so these are things that people have said specifically to me, and I can then go back through those. And I can also take valuable comments that I think I want to retain. I can star them. And then we can also have, for example, guidance to people in the channel as a post can be pinned in such a way that we haven't got any in this particular room here, but they can be pinned so that it provides guidance to people who are maybe using the room for the first time or the channel for the first time. You can also always have a direct communication with any particular user just by clicking on their name. It allows you to have either a video conversation or you can adjust that person's, sorry, Wayne, you can adjust the person's capabilities within a particular channel. You can set them as a moderator, for example. So if it's a discussion where you might be having, for example, spam users, which is always a possibility when you have an open forum like this, the moderator has the ability to remove people from the room if they're not actually there for positive purposes. Okay, and so that we would hope would be both a place for our partner collaborators to discuss the craft of creating or of assembling these OER, the open educational resources, but also a place where our learners can come and speak to each other and perhaps also interact with their with the educators that are running the courses that they're undertaking. Okay, so now we also have a planning system, which some people will have seen. So we're using this as a way of mapping out the things that need to happen for specific initiatives, like the development of a given course, or in the case of the technology working group, we have a technology priorities plan for the minimum viable product. And I'll show you that as soon as it comes up here. So this is built on a platform called WeCan, which is a so-called Kanban board in a digital form. So some people will be familiar with the concept of a Kanban workspace. So Kanban is just a particular well-defined methodology for managing tasks. And so here we go. If I look at our technology priorities Kanban board, you can see that Wayne and I particularly have been involved in a lot of different stuff. We'll let it load here. I think people will find that this will happen much more quickly for them if they're not engaged in the video conference at the moment. Mm-hmm. So you can see that we have different kinds of tasks. Each task, by the way, can be assigned or adopted by a particular member of the particular board. I'm just waiting for this to come up here. Yeah.
Yeah, one of the downsides of Zoom is it consumes a lot of computing resource.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've seen that.
An absurd amount, yes. So unfortunately, yeah, this is the fact that I'm doing this. Unfortunately, Wayne, I couldn't get this to just look at a particular screen. If I make this smaller, it might reduce the amount of video transfer that's going on. Okay, so here I've selected a particular task. And we have the ability here, for example, to go in and alter the description. We can alter who's involved in the actual session. We can adjust, in the actual task, who's got responsibility for it or an interest in it. We can adjust the labels that are applied to it so that you can, at a glance, see things that are high priority, low priority, things that are contentious or not. So there you can define what these colors mean. And then you can have conversations related to a particular task. So as you can see, slowly my computer is populating this with the rest of the activity that's gone on around it. So those activities can be comments, but it also can be the fact that a person was added as a member to a particular task. And so then the idea is that once the task is done, or is in the process of being done, you can shift the task just by dragging its card. You can shift it around into different categories. And all of those changes are recorded in an activity log for the overall board. So everything that's been done ends up being listed in this board. So someone can set it up so that they receive a notification depending on different kinds of actions that happen within a particular board. So for example, if a new card is added, you can receive an email alerting you to that fact, and you can adjust the way that you track it by the category of watching or tracking that you're doing of that particular board. All right. So in any case, there are a number of different boards for different course development, as well as for the meta organization of the OERu, like the technology stuff I just showed you. Okay, so let's go back to the agenda here. We've also introduced an issue tracking system, which may or may not be something that people want to use or find useful, but we figure it's easy to try and see whether it actually fills a requirement. So we've created this issue tracking system, which allows people, for example, to submit a problem that they might have encountered with one of our technologies. Or it could be related to the way that a course is running or something like that as well. And so the idea here is that this is a bug tracking application that allows us to allows people to submit. We can define projects within this, and it allows people to submit issues related to those projects. It was originally designed for software projects, but we believe that it's sufficiently flexible that it can be adapted to be suitable for any other type of project. So we can, for example, you can report an issue, and it just allows you to fill in a form that we can add or remove fields from to streamline it if it's necessary or if it's too verbose as it is. But the idea here is that you can simply submit a report of a problem, and that allows us to then assign responsibility for addressing that issue to someone who is able to actually address it and allows us to ensure that we don't drop any catches, so to speak. We don't have things that people think are important to address that are not being addressed because they haven't been recognized as a problem. Okay. At the moment, that system is relatively unutilized. To provide an update on our single sign-on progress, it is still a work in progress. We are still optimistic that it will be something we can achieve. We're just working through some of the rather tricky technical details of it. But what we've done is we've adopted an approach whereby our course's website, which each learner and anyone who's running a course has to be able to log into, we've decided to use that as our source of authentication. So if someone logs into our course website, they can use those credentials, or eventually when we have this system rolled out, they will be able to use those same credentials on all of our services the same way that, for example, you can go to a website and it will allow you to log in with your Google credentials or your Facebook logon or your Twitter handle or something like that. It would be an equivalent sort of setup where people will not have to create a separate account or separate account credentials for each of our services. They'll simply be able to have their account, their course account will allow them to access all of those different services without having to think up a new password in each case and so on. Right. And finally, as I've alluded to earlier, we've created now a technology blog, the purpose of which is to allow us or provide us a place to describe some of the technological enhancements we've made or new technologies we've introduced into the OERu minimum viable product, and also some of these things that may go beyond that or be a next generation subsequent to that. And the idea is to have a place where our partners can go to learn more about these technologies should they find that some of them are compelling enough for them to want to look at adopting them in their own institutions. So, for example, I've described how in this initial post, I've essentially just given a laundry list of the different type of technologies that we've adopted. So I'll open that one just so you can have a quick look at that. And I've also included a post in which I describe in this case, there's only one really core technology that is not open source that we're using. In fact, it's this very Zoom video conferencing software. And I've described why it is that we've stuck with that. And here's, so you can see what I've explained kind of our underlying motivations for adopting open source software as the underlying technology for the OERu minimum viable product, because of its philosophical and principle-led consistency, among other things, and also the fact that it allows us to move very quickly and with very low upfront financial investment. And it looks at our infrastructure from a physical, it's sort of on the basis of having a stack, as it's called in the technology world, namely, our technologies start with literally physical hardware, which is in a hosting facility somewhere. In fact, this particular website is hosted in Germany on a OERu OER Foundation managed server in Germany. We have other things like Wiki Educator hosted out of the U.S. using Amazon's Elastic Cloud Computing infrastructure. So it's cloud-based infrastructure. But we look at our various externally hosted references or externally hosted services, I should say, and then the ones that we host ourselves. And we also have been writing our own software. For example, WeNotes is a good example of that, which Jim Titzler originally wrote. And also our snapshotting software, which converts a Wiki Educator course into a WordPress course and deploys it onto our WordPress install or onto individual WordPress sites our partners set up. And so this is essentially providing a directory to all of these different resources so that people can investigate them to gain a better understanding of what it is that we're actually doing. And it also will hopefully act as a starting point for more in-depth posts on individual technologies, which will give our partners and our learners, for that matter, insight into how these things have been deployed, and it will make it possible for them to replicate that deployment if they should find it a compelling enough software option. Right. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
Well, I think it shifts nicely into the discussion area. And as I told you in our pre-conference chats, Dave, it's some amazing steps here. And what I really appreciate about the tools you've been rolling out, it's a really great balance between the flexibility and the interoperability and all the benefits of open tools. And you know, we don't have to talk amongst ourselves about why that's a good thing. but also, too, I've been really impressed with everything I've tried out. You know, a really nice emphasis on usability, too. I'm really hoping. So I feel like the most kind of pressing question is almost like thinking about adopting. I think you've laid out a really nice set of tools that I'd like to see what would happen if we can get a wider swath of participants from across the partners, even before we start rolling them out in courses, to get a sense of how adoption of these tools can work a little better. So I'm viewing that as really a key goal that, I don't know if you guys agree, but that seems to me the big glaring thing I would love to see happen.
Yeah. Well, I'm planning to tell people at the, conference in Inverness that, There are some real advantages to adopting some of these technologies because they really are world class. I mean, the one thing that they lack typically is a large corporate marketing budget behind them, and that some people would see that as a good thing. I certainly do. But the idea is that having had an opportunity to actually test some of these tools actively as people working to assemble partner-led courses and for our learners as well. We have people have the option to actually test these things and to confirm for themselves that they work in a way that is useful. And I believe that many of our partners could save far more than the cost of their being involved in the OERu as a partner simply by adopting one of these tools as opposed to the proprietary alternative to it. And in the process of doing so, not only gain that functionality that it provides, but also gain the control and the preservation of their freedom going forward. And we see it as a great advantage to our learners as well, that by adopting these tools, we're also not compromising their freedoms on their behalf, which is often the case in proprietary environments where a student has to buy a particular piece of software by a particular vendor and commit their files and their artifacts into formats and so on, which in turn create a dependence on that vendor's product that they can't break without losing access to their creative activities, their creative endeavors.
Terrifyingly common story. So I mean, I'm interested to know not just how we can support adoption within the context of the OERu activities, but whether we can assist or what, and I think about it even from my selfish point of view, looking at some of this stuff and how we might implement it locally. We've been playing with some of these things locally, but your implementations in every case is better than what we did. So it's really interesting to see that. And because I have to think that if people are using these tools in their local context, that makes it that much easier for them to collaborate using those tools in a consortia like OERu.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Any thoughts, Wayne?
Hey, Brian, totally agree on the adoption points. I mean, it's something that we really need to think about, how to foster this within the network and help people, realize the benefits. Because, there are clearly a number of benefits. I mean, one of the things which I find quite interesting with our model is it's really a petri dish of experimentation and, agility around the whole kind of open design model. Internationally, there are not many folk that are doing it, in any meaningful way at any scale. And we're learning a bunch of stuff. I mean, how do you collaboratively design an open course when you've got folk distributed across the world and the tool set that you need to support that? And that's kind of, we're slowly tweaking and getting better at doing that. For example, the bug tracker is really as a result of one or two course developments where the academic, the SMEs, the subject matter experts went, overboard with email and tracking issues. You just can't keep track of the stuff, right? And so it's all that experimentation. But the real area where I think we got a huge strategic opportunity in this network is in becoming the world's leading providers of open boundary courses. This idea where we have one or two courses on campus, right, which are taught to full fee, full paying students on campus, but studying in parallel with these free learners, and how we get those groups interacting with each other. And our technology stack will enable us to do that. We've done one or two small prototypes and had done some interesting stuff. So one of the thoughts I've got in the back of my mind is I know that a third of our network are run Moodle as their LMS. And I'm sitting wondering if there's any way we can get a club funding kind of concept going to do a custom export of an OERu course, right, for the local Moodle installation. It wouldn't be that hard to do. I mean, this is not a $4 million project. It's probably $50,000 worth of coding or $60,000. I mean, I don't know what the numbers are, but that kind of league, right? And if you've got five partners all putting $5,000 back, get that done. Because there are a couple of interesting fringe cases when you're running an open boundary course. It's the things like how do you get your if a learner registered on the learning management system wants to make a post public to the LMS, how do the people outside the LMS actually see that? And the prototype that we've done in the past is you have a student robot registered as, you know, student rights. And then you have a designated open forum in, you know, in your Moodle, where, you know, you tell the learners, hey, if you posted this, you're going to go to the world, and you know, it's all openly licensed. Mm. So you know, there's it's an opt-in process, right?
Wow.
But then then what the bot does, it watches for those posts, and the moment it sees one, it will replicate that post on one of our servers so that the whole community can see it, and then it's injected into the WeNotes feed. There's some really interesting stuff we can be doing. And I think that has real value for institutions because, you know, on you know, certain courses, you can market this international intercultural learning experience. And we've got, I mean, the fact that we've gone with not using a learning management system for our delivery is not some ideological bent to rid the world of LMSs. But it just gives us that flexibility to be doing some interesting stuff.
Wayne, you said something. I'm documenting some of these things in our notes section here. So I'm just wondering, you said, I like the way you put it, the promise. This is kind of making good on the promise of open boundary courses by allowing or using a default open position with these technologies that make good on the promise of multicultural learning experiences. Is that what you said, or the
I think the benefit that a regional institution can sell to their students in participating in an open boundary course is the ability to participate in an international multicultural learning experience. In other words, the benefit for the students at the local regional institutions. And for example, it's hard for an Otago Polytechnic to provide learners from 120 countries on the on-campus experience.
Yeah.
At OERu can do that.
Yeah, okay. I think I've captured that. Yeah, okay. I'll just save this so you can all see what I've written and make sure that it's this is on the if you refresh the
I'll refresh.
Tell me if I've captured your input. Oh. Sorry, I've done it in such a way that it's not.
I'll slip a note in a little later. Wayne, I love that idea of having some sort of functionality within Moodle that would allow a designated area within a quote-unquote closed environment be able to effortlessly go into a collaborative multi-open space within, say, a Moodle course. That's I never even thought of that idea before. That's such a neat idea.
Yeah, all it would basically require in Moodle is just a bit of local code to be installed on the local. I mean, we're a trusted partner, so it's just the ability to introduce a trusted robot that only does things that it's allowed to do, which, for example, an open designated forum. It's also actually interesting watching the learner behaviors in those kinds of environments, because you'll have. So, I mean, the whole thing is that the toolset students are entitled to the total support that they're getting from the institution. You know, the banking fees are perfectly legit. And so that's why that closed environment is important. But it's interesting watching learners in these courses. Some of the learners actually are using the open tools outside. But obviously they can, right? They're open by definition. That sort of interface is really very interesting because it really helps with the maturation of, I mean, it's a cliche term, but you'll know what I'm on about the digital literacy, the learning literacy of the digital century.
By the way, Dave, when you're typing, yep. You might want to mute your microphone.
Sorry, I wasn't sure if that was causing a problem.
Apologies. It's all right. It's no big deal. Just letting you know. No, that's a really interesting idea, Wayne. I don't know if we'll be able to get discussion like that going at the meeting or not, but I sure would like to see where that could go somewhere.
Yeah.
And I guess the other part, I guess, where I'd be interested in discussing before we sign off, besides future direction, is Hopefully we can have a discussion on where partners can help in this area. I mean, besides participating in a working group, which obviously we need to do another recruiting drive, whether it is adopting some of these tools locally and building some local expertise, is it creating documentation, for example, code contributions, are there gaps where institutions say, you know, I might have some expertise with specific tools? That's a discussion I'm hoping we can have. And I don't have answers for those right now, but that's something I think we'd like to discuss.
Yeah, I'm just nodding my head. I don't know if you chatted about this earlier in your discussions, but one of the partners, in fact, Athabasca University, has actually developed a bit of code for a web service to generate offline snapshots of OERu courses.
I think that did come up, but I'd forgotten.
That's a good point. We should add that.
Yeah, and the point being, I'm not pointing fingers at AU or the developer, because he's a very smart developer. It was just something that, you know, he put together to save himself time on another project, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's an incredibly smart idea, and you know, if we get a bit of collaboration going on those sort of strategic grease points, right? We could do some really amazing stuff. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine the power of being able to have every single OERu course available in offline format for people that have expensive connectivity? I mean, it's huge.
Mm-hmm.
Then you start thinking of the smart tech things that you can be doing with that. So local mesh networks for learner groups to interact with each other and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
You do some cool stuff.
Very cool. Awesome. I feel like I've chipped in the little bits. Obviously, this was a very heavy focus, justifiably so, on all the great work Dave has done since the last partners meeting. Is there any other final thoughts we want to fire in before we wrap up the recording?
Not from my desk.
I'm just trying to record some of these pearls of wisdom so that they will be discoverable by others in going forward. I think we should do maybe a tech blog would be appropriate for Dan Wilton's, is it Dan Wilton, is that his surname, Wilton? His work on the snapshot functionality, so we can kind of explain the implications of it, because I don't know that it's obvious. It would be obvious. It certainly wasn't obvious to me initially when I saw it, but upon hearing your description there, Wayne, that made me realize that it actually has reasonably profound implications, particularly for the fact that many of our, you know, many of the people who would benefit most from what the OERu is doing currently won't have reliable access to the internet. And so what we can do as a stopgap measure, as connectivity is getting better rapidly around the world, it won't have gotten to everyone yet. So we can come up with ways
maybe we could
help people with that in the meantime.
What we could do is maybe just invite Dan offline if he'd be keen on writing up Dan.
Yeah, that's a good idea too. Yeah, okay.
Great. I'll probably contact you offline for an idea for a post or two as well. And I'll just check in with you before I do it to make sure it's kind of on message.
Yeah, that'd be cool, Brian.
Okay. Should we wrap this up? We're a little over an hour in.
Sure.
Thanks very much. And I'm really looking forward to seeing both of you in person very soon.
Indeed. Yeah, I guess we should point out for people watching this that this is a Trans-Pacific video conference, with you, Brian, being in British Columbia, and Wayne and I are both in New Zealand, in different parts of New Zealand, as it happens. So we're not actually in the same city, but in Christchurch and Dunedin, in New Zealand.
Dunedin's Silicon Valley, which is
most. That's right. That's right. Indeed, of course, how could I have forgotten that? Okay, should we sign off?
Yes, please. Thank you very much, guys.
Hey, gentlemen, thank you.
Bye-bye.